So in April, we have Sylvan Senior from the University of New Hampshire. I can't remember the exact date, but you'll be finding out. Do you remember the 11th? She'll be here as a second speaker. And both of them are doing cutting edge work in cultural theory, literary theory, and they are teaching classes in our department, so some of you are from those classes. And they are kind of sparking some discussion in our department about new trends in critical theory. The first speaker, who I will introduce now, is Karen Raber from the University of Mississippi. And she and I first met at the University of California, San Diego, many years ago in graduate school, and she had been at Yale and in the graduate program at Hopkins. And to my good fortune and the good fortune of other graduate students and faculty there, she decided to come to the University of California, San Diego. And one of the things I remember about her, besides that she was a stimulating presence in all of our seminars and classes, is that she was doing fascinating work on women writers. And when I was an undergraduate, I'd been told that we didn't really have to read women writers in the Renaissance because there weren't very many of them, and the ones that existed were not any good. And I was disabused of that in graduate school, thankfully, and Karen was one of the people that disabused me of that. And she was working on Elizabeth Carey, among other women writers. Margaret Cavendish is another writer that she has published on since then. She went on soon after graduate school to work in the field known as animal studies, and she wrote a book that has inspired me to get into the field called Animal Bodies, Renaissance Culture, and that came out in 2013. And it's been a very important work. She is currently working on 5 different projects, all in progress and at presses. Actually, so I'm correcting her CV, which only has 4, because I know about the 5th. So they include Animals at the Table, Making Meat in Early Modern Europe, Shakespeare and Animals, a dictionary, Shakespeare and Posthumanist Theory, and Performing Animals, which she's co-editing. And she also is now putting together the Rutledge Handbook on Shakespeare and Animals, so 5 book projects. So the articles, I was going to try and read the articles from 2016, thinking that would be easy enough, but actually too many to read, it would take too long. But I'll just mention a couple. Monster Pets just came out in Early Modern Culture, and The Chicken and the Egg, Animal Nature in Troilus and Cressida in Shakespeare in Our Time. So I want to thank Karen for coming here. It's really a delight having you, and let's give her a hand.
Thank you so much, everybody. I feel exhausted after hearing that. Thank you for that really lovely introduction, and I want to thank the English department for inviting me, and those of you in it that I've met already and some that I haven't, for coming and for hosting me, and thank you also to all of the students who seem to have shown up. That's wonderful. I'm going to just very briefly lay out where this project comes from. Origins are in that book project that Ben mentioned, the Animal Bodies book, where I was talking about animal embodiment, has a chapter in it on the erotic connection between horse and rider as it's represented primarily in the horsemanship treatises and in some of the literature in the Renaissance. I have been drawn back repeatedly to that topic, and this is one of the stages of that constant recycling. Largely because I think it's not yet a fully explored topic. My argument in the book was that by neglecting the erotics of the relationship and always collapsing it into sexual, particularly bestial relationships, which is what most critics had done in animal studies to that point, we miss dimensions and possibilities that we should otherwise explore. And of course, I understand that the reason why it's difficult to make this kind of argument has to do with the bestiality and other kinds of non-normative sexualities have always been lumped together and demonized. Nevertheless, I wanted to take a risk. So this is a stage of the process, and at the Shakespeare Association of America next month, I'm going to be giving a talk on a plenary panel that continues this process by looking at a phenomenology of the early modern horse-human dyad. So, I come at Shakespeare's Prince Henry, from Henry IV, Part 1, primarily, from behind. From the tale of another historically prior Henry and his incarnation as a rider with a vulnerable posterior. Reporting a series of near-death visions of purgatory, 12th century monk Edmund of Ensham describes one that features his king, Henry II, punished in the afterlife for his sins by being forced to ride a hellish steed. Oh, come on now, this worked before. Of course, now it does. All right,
there it goes.
Take this. Technology, it never does what it's So that's the quote, and I'm going to read through it. It's really impressive. He sat upon a horse that blew out of its mouth and nose a flame as black as pitch, mixed with the smoke and stench of hell, unto the grievous torment of him that sat above, who was fully armed as if he were going to battle. Truly, the armor that he wore was to him intolerable pain, for it was like bright burning iron is when it is beaten between white hammers and sends out fiery sparks, with which he was inwardly burnt all over. And on the outside, the same armor burned him with a very great heat and weighted down him who wore it with a very sore burden. Also, the saddle that he sat in was pierced through on both sides with fiery spikes and nails, which were a ghastly sight for any man to behold. And the maw and inward bowels of him who sat in the saddle were sorely smitten through by the sharpness of the spikes and nails. And thus cruelly was he punished for the unrightful shedding of men's blood and for the foul sin of adultery. This image of divine retribution was particularly apt.
Mm-hmm.
For like any other medieval noble, one of Henry's most potent constitutive relationships must be with a horse. A monarch, in particular, must ride, and more specifically must ride to war in armor, mounted on a destrier which he controls skillfully in order to merit his title. The fact that Edmund's vision works so viscerally on the reader or auditor, moreover, has to do with the nature of the rider's interaction with this horse through a particular place of conjunction, crotch to saddle and saddle to horse's back. Edmund's term for the area involved in the more pointed and pointy part of the punishment, the word bowels, covers the entire lower region of the rider's body, a good portion of which is cradled by the saddle, an important and intimate piece of technology for connecting equine and human bodies. Edmund's account literally casts, as if he were metal in a mold, Henry's identity within the mold of the medieval tradition of chivalry through that burning armor that works on his flesh like a forge. Riding is an ideologically charged skill, conveying the authority of the rider to control the bestial passions of the masses as their rightful ruler. As Jeffrey Jerome Cohen points out, chivalric accomplishments are further tied to the achievement of perfected manhood in the medieval tradition. But however great Henry's riderly ability and consequent monarchical privilege, both are here punctured and dissolved along with Henry's flesh in the most cringeworthy fashion. Heated to melting by his white-hot armor, Henry's genitalia are roasted and speared simultaneously. Instead of controlling his mount through the technology of saddle and stirrup, Henry is literally nailed to his horse, the vulnerable flesh of his posterior penetrated, bleeding. The presumed heat of his adulterous passion is translated into internal and external burning, and instead of weighing down the body of his adulterous lover, Henry is himself burdened by his armor. Edmund's image enacts a multivalent assault on the king's body then, both corporeal and legal, but one that depends on the intervening existence and agency of the animal that moves between Henry's legs, as well as the equipment associated with medieval chivalric accomplishments. The monk's punitive fantasy evokes the erotics of the contact zone represented by the saddle, the place between horse and human that translates motion, will, desire, resistance, and obedience from one body to another. But it does so in order to impose an inverted regime of penetration as the basis for its image of suffering. Instead of the rider's spur or the bit, he handles penetrating his mount. Here, the mount and equipment penetrate the rider. Henry's superheated armor transforms the material meant to protect and envelop him, and we might also think about it as marking the boundaries between himself as a human and the animal, as well as a man versus anything else, into a sadomasochistic engine that disintegrates what it's supposed to keep hold. Without Henry's infernal horse, there would, however, be no need for saddle, no occasion for armor, both of which collude to render Henry simultaneously not ruler but subject, not agent but object, not erotic, adulterous master, but slave to the heat of someone else's, maybe Edmund's or the infernal mount's, vengeful desire. In her contribution to Madhvi Menon's collection, Shakespeare, Laurie Shannon asks, quote, whether queerness is conceptually limited to human exceptionalist applications. By linking body, sexuality, identity, and history in a reading of Shakespeare's play, Henry IV, Part 1, mostly, this essay responds to Shannon's question by exploring the fraught erotic contact zone between horse and rider, which I argue structures a few crucial moments involving the play's uncanny twins, Hotspur and Hal. While brilliant arguments queering the relationship between these two characters have already appeared, they are, I argue, incomplete because they limit themselves to an understanding of an exclusively human sexuality. And instead, I analyze how embodied connections, or a lack thereof, between these characters and the play's non-human creatures disturb human exceptionalism by queering, literally veering, rerouting, reorienting, the erotic relationships in the play. So, here's the second quote for you. Come, declaims Hotspur in the play's fourth act, on the eve of battle in which he will finally fight his alter ego, Prince Hal. Let me taste my horse, who is to bear me like a thunderbolt against the bosom of the Prince of Wales. Harry to Harry shall hot horse to horse meet, and there apart till one drop down a corpse. True to his name and character, Hotspur champs at the bit to slaughter Prince Hal. Portrayed throughout the play as a noble horseman, a virtual centaur whose union with his mount defines him, the moment plays out the contrast between the two Harrys in the language and imagery of horses and horsemanship. It's common to all Shakespeare's history plays, but particularly present in the second tetralogy. Rob Watson's observed the equestrian context for Hotspur's battle with Hal emphasizes the link between riderly self-mastery and political authority. Bruce Bohr agrees and further reads Hotspur's language here as an indication that he belongs to the category that includes, quote, women, fools, and children for expressing, quote, the bestial and childish impulses of a rebellious subject. The degree of intimacy Hotspur here enjoys with his horse certainly prefigures more extreme version of horse love later offered by the infantile Dauphin in Henry V, who is the one who challenges Henry with the balls, the tennis balls. And like the Dauphin, Hotspur is destined to fall to Hal's inexorable progress towards masculine maturity. At Shrewsbury, Hotspur and Hal do finally meet, although not on horseback, and in the event, it turns out to be Hotspur who drops down a corpse. Both Jonathan Goldberg and Matt Bell have argued that the two Harrys are erotically as well as structurally and politically linked. In Goldberg's reading, critics' great pleasure in Hal's arrival as king is suspect for its tendency to obscure or ignore the prince's narcissistic self-possession, which undergirds the play's scheme to replace biological legitimacy with simulation and image production. Hal's blot, says Goldberg, is embodied in Falstaff, his rebellion in Hotspur. They wear two of the faces of what the period calls sodomy, broadly understood to include rebellion and transgression. Discussing the above moment, or this moment of Hotspur's hypermasculine longing for a hot encounter with Hal, and that's Goldberg's word, hypermasculine, Goldberg explains its thigh action by referring it immediately to Vernon's heavily eroticized report of Hal leaping into his own saddle, which is what immediately precedes this quote. We'll see it later. And this is Goldberg's words. His thighs tightly clenching the horse beneath, throned like Hotspur would be on his roan, the male horse whom he straddles. The thigh wound Hal cannot give his alter ego, delivered instead by a counterfeiting Falstaff, suggests the kind of encounter Hal might desire but instead must reject. Goldberg's reading of the second tetralogy is qualified by Bell's analysis of the mirroring that we find in that hot horse passage. with its repetition of Harry, Harry, and horse, horse. So the two characters' uncanny sameness, Bell proposes, figures love's likeness, that's his line, in the nearly matrimonial quality of the two Harrys' mutual devotion, not in order to imply a homosexual or even a homoerotic bond between the two, but to mark its repression, the negation of love that makes a reader shiver at this creepy doubling. Although the play seems to present Hotspur as divider and Hal as unifier, their uncanny sameness belies the logic of such contrast. On the battlefield, Hal triumphs by incorporating Hotspur, eliminating the threat of sameness through an act of violence that Hal himself elegizes in his eulogy, doing fair rites of tenderness, as he calls it, for his dead double. So we have then two important readings based in queer theory that deal with this moment and the two characters involved. Yet both ignore entirely the animals upon whose backs the whole image rides. The moment is, I think, therefore even more and differently queer than either author allows, and it is so because of the embodied connection it expresses, not only between Harry and Harry, but between Harry and his horse and Harry and his horse. Indeed, the heat of passion in this passage arises not exclusively from its two human actors, but also from the two mounts, hot horse to hot horse, that are at once agents, vehicles, and mediators of the encounter. Including the horse as an actor in a drama involving erotic doubling is not unusual in Shakespeare's work. Actually, this happens quite a bit more than I'm even going to point out here. Having come at Hotspur and Hal from behind, we might now leap ahead to another play that uses a related device. Hamlet goes further even than Henry IV Part I by doubling Hamlet at least twice, in Fortinbras and in Laertes, his two mirror foils. When Claudius plots to have Laertes duel Hamlet, he momentarily introduces another horseman, this one a reflection of death itself, the Norman La Morgue, which is a play on L-A-M-O-R-T. Claudius describes La Morgue's equestrian skill, so I'm just quoting little bits from this. He grew unto his seat, and such a wondrous doing brought his horse, as he had, as had he been encorpsed and demi-natured with the brave beast. Claudius tells Laertes that Lamorne is the channel by which Laertes' skill with the sword has been broadcast, and has thus roused Hamlet's jealousy. Quote, this report of his did Hamlet so envenom with his envy that he could nothing do but wish and beg your sudden coming over to play with you. Granted, Claudius is probably making it all up to push Laertes into a fight, but what earthly purpose does the fact of Lamorne's horsemanship serve in this scene? Nobody seems to think about that much. If Claudius' goal is to force Laertes to accept the fight in order to protect the proposed image of himself as Hamlet's superior and the source of extreme envy in his rival, why is it necessary to name Lamorne and describe his bewitching seat on an equine partner? And the answer I'm going to propose is that a set of desires is being established here and then oriented. Arising partly from Claudius' machinations, partly out of the already established mirroring of the two young men, these desires are yet more powerful when rooted through the image of a rider encorpsed with a horse. That is the union of horse and rider, the physical indistinguishability of one from the other, projects the intimate relationship that Claudius hints Hamlet might desire with Laertes. And in turn, Laertes is encouraged to imagine himself in just such an erotic tangle with his appointed foe. Hamlet wants nothing so much as to play, that is fence, but also toy and sport and fool around, right? With Laertes, to prove his own bravery and test his opponents, to accomplish feats that would resonate retroactively with the bravery of Lamorne's mount and its skilled rider. By triangulating Hamlet's desire for Laertes and Laertes for Hamlet through Lamorne and his mount, Claudius achieves a heightened, eroticized compliance from his target, from Laertes, who will rise to the occasion of the tainted duel. The horse, rather than incidental to the doubling and deaths of the two swordsmen, is a crucial motivator, a vehicle not merely of a great rider, but of the quasi-amatory encounter that Laertes comes, brought in by Claudius, to crave from Hamlet. In their duel, we later witness Laertes receiving Hamlet's, quote, offered love like love, whereupon he is palpably hit, and that's a pun on a sexual act, by Hamlet, which he confesses, another term that has multiple meanings, and then is made wanton by his doomed opponent, and all of these terms in which the duel is cast have these potential sexual erotic meanings. Queering in such a textual moment, as many queer theorists have suggested, involves veering, swerving, and confusing supposedly normative erotic directionality. So it's fitting then to take a little bit of a detour or two to consider what part the horse has in bending the homoerotic doublings of these two plays. Recent work in animal studies has drawn greater attention to such moments in literature, insisting that we recognize the fundamental role of animals in constructing the very category of the human, let alone individual identities like Laertes or Hotspurs. But critical investment in reading animals for their influence on the erotics of early modern cultural works is so far limited, often by the rush to assimilate eroticism to bestiality. This is the problem. As I've argued elsewhere, this kind of immediate move from the presence of the animal to bestial sexual acts is worth resisting, not only, I argue, because of the attendant political and social ramifications of the alignment of homosexuality with bestiality and other forms of socially prescribed sexual choice in current culture, but also because it collapses the space in which animals might function as erotic agents rather than faced victims, and it limits our ability to recognize fundamental challenges to the whole concept of normativity as a human standard. To appreciate what horses do in the Hotspur Hal dyad, we need to consider the embodied connection that links horse with rider further, and consequently links human with equine erotics. I propose that to do so, we employ a bit of what's sometimes called cognitive ecology, a collection of methodologies that seek to explain the embodied nature of cognition. In an early cluster on eco-criticism in Shakespeare's survey, Evelyn Tribble and John Sutton suggest cognitive ecology's value in opposing traditional materialist and rationalist explanations of mind and body, those that trace their lineage to Descartes' assertion of the cogito, and they embrace instead anti-individualist and anti-rationalist approaches to cognition. The approach also tends to reject not just mind-body dualism, but actually any coherent phenomenological distinction among categories of being or experience, between subjects and objects, between environments of interiority and those of a material exteriority. While these methods have not generally been employed to describe eroticism and sexuality, there's no reason why they shouldn't be, especially since they're most apt in elucidating the type and nature of the interaction Hotspur imagines with Hal. Anthropologist, sociologist, and cyberneticist Gregory Bateson has famously interrogated the whole idea of bodily limits and their relationship to the cognitive perception of information, and by extension, the construction of selfhood. Bateson's most cited example is of a blind man's cane. I don't know if you know Bateson's work, but this is everybody remembers this one. Where, Bateson asks, does cognition begin and end if perception of his environment is only available through such an instrument? So, who's to say that that cane is not as much part of the blind man's body as anything else one might call one's own body? Andy Clark and David Chalmers have articulated also a model of the extended mind that advances Bateson's thought, in which objects and mental processes function in a kind of continuous feedback loop with environment and individual continuously influencing what can be apprehended. Cognition does not end at the boundaries of the skull or even the body, but continues and is reciprocally shaped through any number of other bodies, minds, or objects. And when I'm teaching this stuff, I always use the example of the smartphone, which at this point has become your mind outside of your mind, right? Most of us no longer think, we just go to the phone, we Google stuff. Where the study of animals is concerned, cognitive ecology has the potential to open up discussion of what Merleau-Ponty calls interanimality, the collective and often mutual participation of animals and humans in the flesh of the world. Cognitive ecology implicitly invites us not only, as post-humanist critics would require, to attend to animals' presences in literary texts, but to rethink the content of presence itself, moving away from debates about reason or mind that reproduce, even if critically, the Cartesian cogito, moving instead towards a sense of the world that is always embodied, always shared, always mutual, and in which there is only an unstable boundary between inside and outside, subject and object. From such a position, I argue that we understand neither Hotspur nor Hal if we ignore the embodied engagement of both with the animals and the environment through which they're constructed in place. So take, for instance, the sheer basic material encounter zone constituted by the horse's back and the rider's posterior. Gibson proposes a useful, fluid, multidirectional model of perceptual interactions between body and environment that accounts for the nuances of that zone. In a Gibsonian reading, the shape of the horse is
especially its back behind its withers, provides what he calls an affordance to the human body. It immediately perceptually makes available as a place of contact the inverted V of human legs. So it's something that humans, in other words, recognize and that operates almost at a completely subconscious level, at a material level. That perceptual potential for conjoining, for conjunction, is appropriated and made concrete in the design of a saddle, which must reproduce and enhance the experience of mutual balance and stability in horse and rider. When the monk of Ensham imagines saddle nails driving upward into Henry II's flesh, he reverses this process, reorganizing the possibility of the back and saddle so that the saddle divides the body from its intended extension, the horse. What is unnatural about Edmund's fantasy is not only the inversion of power between subject and monarch, but the perversion of a carefully designed instrument, the saddle, its transformation from nicely crafted echo of the thighs and crotch into an object with new affordances for pain. Hotspur's speech about tasting his horse conveys the degree to which his character, like any horseman's in the period, is structured through his sensory engagement with another creature. The functions of his horse are multiple. It's an instrument for negotiating the broader perceptual environment in which Hotspur operates, and it's an independent environment in itself with its own agency and needs. It's an extension also of Hotspur's mind and will, performing actions that its rider commands to make him something greater than he is alone, turning him into a thunderbolt, a force of nature. Horsemanship's mixture of sensory feedback and kinetic activity are also, the passage suggests, the primary means by which Hotspur reflexively conceives himself and his relations to others. In other words, to be very brief, Hotspur can't imagine a Hal who is not also mounted, not also always riding a hot horse, not also one with his mount, as Hotspur is in the tradition of great horsemen, and therefore can't imagine a Hal who is not merged with that animal in a unique cross-species union. For such an equestrian, the profound pleasure of riding comes in part from the physical experience of rhythmic, explosive motions generated by a body outside of oneself, a body more powerful and agile, whose efforts fleetingly register as if they were one's own. Psychologists, cultural anthropologists, and animal ethicists have coined a number of terms to convey this kind of bodily distribution, and this is actually still part of cognitive ecology. Merleau-Ponty was perhaps the first to identify it as a kinetic melody of body and behavior, a phrase that Elizabeth Le Guin evokes in her work on the harmony required in horsemanship treatises and in her comparison of horsemanship with musical study. Psychologist Kenneth Shapiro calls it kinesthetic empathy, and anthropologist Thomas Sordis brands it a form of somatic attention. French ethologist and equestrian Jean-Claude Barret notes that the most infinitesimal and involuntary motion of the rider